Warning, we are about to spoil Bad Times at the El Royale. If you haven't seen the film and plan on watching it, then click away now. Or if you've already seen it, or you just don't care, then please stick around.
Cameron, no.
What?
We can't do it.
We can't do what?
We're not setting the casino on fire.
But it'll match the movie.
And scene. I guess.
I guess so. All right. I don't know. I mean, the casino's still on fire, but you know. Oh,
son of a bitch.
Hello, everybody.
Hi.
And welcome to Cinema Roulette. Again.
Yes.
Yes.
Again.
This is the best intro of all time. I don't know what you're talking about. This is perfect.
Welcome to Friday.
Friday.
I don't know why I'm bringing up the days. I guess it's just to remember.
Yeah.
Or if something isn't posted on time, it makes it funny.
Yes.
Banter noises.
Ah, wow. Listen to all this banter.
Actually, wait. No, there is a thing to say. I do highly recommend going into this movie blind.
Yeah.
That's how I actually watched it by accident. I'll explain that later. Well, actually later. It's an after the intro thing. But yes, it is a fun one to go in very blind to.
Yeah. Go into it knowing as little as possible so you'll be pleasantly surprised by all the shit that goes down. So.
I mean, it still holds up to a rewatch. I can tell you that as well. But you know, it's fun to have that first experience.
Yes. Segues are hard.
This Bad Times at the El Royale. Come on, feet. Start moving. Got to get me
there. Oh. Hey. Editing. It's hard. It is hard, but it is fun.
Is it, though?
Yes.
Except TV episodes.
Those just take a lot. They're not hard. They're just
annoying.
Long. Yeah, it's like it's not hard to do. It's just there's so much just inherently with television.
It's because basically the entire episode is a summary, and summaries are annoying because we pause a lot trying to think of how to continue talking.
Yeah.
But also, we went quiet.
Yeah, we did. Hey, there it is. I was waiting for it. So, yeah, Bad Times at the El Royale. How did you find out about this movie?
Okay, I knew it existed because it was made by the director who did Cabin in the Woods.
Mm-hmm.
However, what happened is I was looking for Hotel Artemis, a movie that came out, I think, the same year. And I thought we had, I think, Showtime at the time. And I was looking through the movies and I was just like, oh, Bad Times at the El Royale. That's that one movie where everyone gets in a fight in the hotel with Jeff Goldblum. That's Hotel Artemis.
Mm-hmm.
However, I turned on the movie thinking it was that. I kept getting them confused because they're both having to do with hotels. Technically a motel in this movie, but besides the point.
Yeah.
I realized about 10 minutes in, this is the wrong movie. But I'm interested, so I sat through the whole thing, even though it's like two and a half hours.
Yeah.
Which is long.
It is long.
It's a long movie.
It is.
But I'm sure the summary will be easy and short.
Mm-hmm.
Because not much happens.
Yup. That is sarcasm, ladies and gentlemen.
That is sarcasm for those of you who were good and watched the movie.
Yes. All right, so.
Also, that again, the YouTube version. Hi. We're on camera.
Yes, we are.
I have a green shirt.
He does.
Cameron, do a thing.
I'll do a thing. Okay.
Cool.
Bam.
Yeah, there it is.
I just unplugged my headphones.
Nice. Well, that is, in fact, doing a thing.
Yes, it is. I like Photoshop, like a green screen my headphones into your chest.
No, just the wire.
Just the wire, yeah. DVD box set of the wire.
Oh, no. Are you enjoying this audio audience?
Yes. We hope you're enjoying all these funny visual gags.
These visual gags that can be found on YouTube. Yes. If you just look up Cinema Roulette or whatever Cameron's channel is called now.
It's always been CamCam, but the thing is...
It wasn't always CamCam.
Well, no, it wasn't always CamCam, but that's... I haven't changed it since the rebrand, I guess you want to say.
The rebrand.
But, yeah, because if you search CamCam, there's a lot of other CamCams, surprisingly.
It's easy.
Yeah. So if you look up CamCam Gaming, then I'll usually pop up.
Or just Cinema Roulette.
It's easier if you just type in Cinema Roulette, frankly.
Honestly. Anyway, summaries are hard.
Yes.
So let's start up. We see a man in a a motel room. He digs up the floorboards, puts some bag in the floorboards, covers everything back up, and waits. Someone comes to the door. He opens it, gets shot with a shotgun. Neat.
Mm-hmm.
10 years later, okay, this is an ensemble cast, so if I fuck things up, I apologize, but I really don't.
It's all good.
It has been 10 years after, and the hotel is far out of its prime. We have an up-and-coming singer named Darlene. We have Father Flynn, a priest. We have, okay, this is a slight spoiler. He has two names. I'm going to call him Dwight because that's why I ran the credits.
Mm-hmm.
We have a vacuum cleaning salesman named Dwight. We have someone named Fuck Off. And we have the person who is running the hotel, Miles. Someone who is just clearly uncomfortable with running the place.
Yeah. And in case you don't know, like in the hotel ledger, she literally writes her name as Fuck You.
Her name is Emily.
Emily is her actual name.
But they all kind of banter and all get their rooms. The whole setup of the El Royale, or the special thing, is it's on the border of Nevada and California, so you can enjoy the luxuries of California, enjoy the gambling of Nevada.
Yep.
Except the place doesn't have a gambling license.
Yeah. It's kind of funny.
That's one of the reasons it's closed.
Mm-hmm.
But okay, we start to see Dwight looking around. And then he pulls out his vacuum case and pulls out another suitcase. It was a bag within a bag.
Ah.
He goes around his room finding bugs. Like, not insects, like wire bugs. For all of you who've seen spy movies. Basically microphones, for those who haven't.
Yes.
He pulls out a ton of them. He comes across Miles again, who is basically passed out on heroin.
Yeah.
And finds secret back rooms of the hotel with one-way mirrors. We see Father Flynn digging into his floorboards. We see Arlene practicing singing. And we see Emily with someone who's tied up and gagged. So that's fun.
Mm-hmm.
Dwight is like, okay, shit's kind of fucked. Goes and calls his boss. His boss is the government. He is a secret agent. He's a Fed.
Yeah, he's a Fed. Because he's talking to J. Edgar Hoover directly, so.
Yeah. He's like, yo, things are kind of compromised here. There are wire bugs that aren't ours. There's someone being held hostage. Can I do something about the hostage thing? Don't do anything about the hostage thing. Well.
He does something about the hostage thing.
He does. He also is told to disable all the cars, which I really want to know. If everything went to plan, what his explanation would have been.
Yeah, like, how would he have explained that?
I just happened to take all your cards. Okay, yeah. I'm a Fed.
Yeah. Oh, where they went, not in my trunk or anything.
Well, he'd have to give them back so they could leave after he's done.
He would, yeah. He's like, okay, you get this back, you get this back. Why did you take it? Okay, I'm a Fed.
Okay, things are about to get complicated because there's a lot of time jumping.
Yes.
But I'm going to try to go in order of events. So, Father Flynn takes Darlene out back to the main part of the hotel to have a drink. They eat dinner. He finally convinces her to have a drink. And he's about to basically roofie her, but she realizes it and smacks him outside the head with a bottle. We also find out here that Flynn has memory problems.
Yep.
Most likely Alzheimer's.
Yeah.
Or dementia.
One of the two. And, like, I think the doctor in the hospital said, like, he got in the fights all the time, too, which didn't help, like, his brain and stuff.
Yeah. So. But why would a priest get in fights? We'll talk about that.
Yes.
Okay. So, Darlene tries to leave. But her car won't start. She sees Dwight sneaking around. Father Flynn is woken up by Miles. And Miles is trying to confess his sins. But Flynn's just like, my fucking head hurts. I want a drink.
Yeah. He's like, not now, kid.
He then asks for the skeleton key of the hotel, basically.
Mm-hmm.
but Dwight took that earlier, and Miles is like, where the fuck did I put it? And he shows Flynn the secret back room, because Miles also knows about it. We also see that there's a camera back there, so it's a perv hotel.
Yeah. Everyone's like, so is this a perv hotel? It's like, yes.
Yeah, it's a perv hotel. But how does everyone find out? Well,
about that.
About that. Flynn and Miles go all the way down and see Emily holding the hostage. Okay, and Dwight wants to do something about the hostage thing. He goes to the door and is like, hey, I'm so... As a massive rainstorm has started. Hey, I've come to check on the women because it's the 70s and that's a valid excuse. So, and Emily's just like, fuck off. So he was about to, but then he kicks in the door. He tries to save Rose. But Emily has a sawed-off shotgun under the bed, pulls it out, and shoots him right in front of the mirror. He flies back, breaks the mirror. Also, Miles is on the other side of the window and gets hit with some of the buckshot and shattering glass.
Yeah, it hits him in the head, but it doesn't kill him because, you know, it already went through John Hamm's body and it wasn't powerful enough to actually...
Yeah. So now he's two-faced. I'm sure this means nothing. Flynn sees this from a distance and runs away. He goes and talks with, Emily kind of talks to Miles like, what the fuck? This is a perv hotel. It turns out the person tied up is Emily's sister named Rose, and Emily is taking Rose away from someone.
Mm-hmm.
Hope it isn't a sexy man.
Yeah, right?
But Rose takes this time, as Emily is yelling at Miles, to make a phone call. This is totally not important. She tells whoever's on the phone where they are, and then goes back to following Emily. Emily ties up Miles, trying to figure out what the hell's going on, as Rose fucks around in the main lobby. Father Flynn goes to Darlene and is like, okay, sorry about the drugging thing. There's a shit ton of money in your room. Because earlier he was flipping a coin between two rooms. God damn it, that was my Discord sound. Don't worry.
It's all good. I don't know if my phone's muted. Let me double check. Yeah, it's muted.
Cool. I had flow. Damn it.
Got to get back into the rhythm. The beat, the flow.
Well, he tells Darlene there's money in her room because he forgot which room it was in. Because it turns out Flynn is a bank robber.
Yep. Straight up crook.
He robbed an armored truck 10 years ago. His brother is the one that went to the El Royale and buried the money. Everything went sideways, so he got caught and was in prison for 10 years, which is where he got into fights and where he found out he has something wrong with his brain. It's the 70s. It's hard to do medical stuff.
Yep.
So. And, Darlene now has Dwight's gun.
Yep.
Actually, this is important. I didn't really have to bring it up. Because she's going to lose him. But first.
Was Paul Walker going to come looking for it?
References to the last episode. Go watch it, please.
Please? That would really be nice.
But he hears him out and is like, okay, if the money isn't there, I'm going to shoot you in the head.
Fair enough.
But they kind of sneakily do it because they know they also saw the bullet. Darlene saw the Fed get shot, so she knows about the back hallway, and Flynn has already seen them.
Yeah, because, like, she takes her gun and goes into the hallway. That's how Darlene knew about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and she went in the room to get the gun, so saw the hallway. Yeah. But, so while they're in the room, Darlene sings to cover up the noise of him, of Father Flynn digging up the floorboards behind the beds.
It's kind of weird, because every time she claps, like, doo-doo, like, he goes, doo-doo.
Yeah, he hits the hammer, which is lucky that she did that because Emily was watching.
Yes.
Because she was trying to figure out where the fuck everyone was, but she never saw the father, so she was free. She was like, where the fuck is he?
Yeah.
But then her sister, as Miles is kind of begging for his life, her sister Rose is like, oh, don't worry, we don't get to decide. What do you mean we don't get to decide, Rose? Who does?
I wonder who it could be.
Hey, you guys ready for cult stuff? Did you expect cult stuff in this movie? I fucking didn't.
Cult stuff just kind of happens.
I mean, I kind of got it when I was watching when the way Rose was, or Emily was talking to Rose.
Yeah.
And after seeing Chris Hemsworth on the beach.
Yeah, because you do see a brief glimpse of him earlier.
Yeah, they do actually bring him up. Isn't complete. Just out of nowhere.
Isn't that right, Channing Tatum?
No one gets that joke.
I know they don't.
The only way to explain is to spoil a different movie.
Yep, I know. And I don't care.
Fair enough. We've done it before.
Yes, we have.
But, oh wait, I'm actually on the second page of notes. Yeah. Ooh,
Ting tang, walla walla, bing bang.
But, let me figure out his name again. Billy Lee, played by Chris Hemsworth, is a cult leader who got Rose to join, and then Rose tried to get Emily to join, but Emily was like, wow, this is fucking cult stuff, and took her sister in the night to try and get away.
Mm-hmm.
That's who Emily called. Him and his cult followers hold out, well, first stop Flynn and Darlene from escaping with the money.
Yeah, they catch them as they're on their way out to get to the car.
Yeah. And, hold on, trying to think here. And brings everyone to the main room. Lee gives a cocky speech and then starts playing roulette. Bet on... One person bets on black, one person bets on red. Loser gets shot in the face.
Yep.
Emily gets shot in the face.
Not really in the face, more in the heart, I think.
Oh, it wasn't the heart. Emily is super dead.
Yeah.
That's not me being joking. Anyway, she's dead. She doesn't come back.
Straight up, she is actually dead at that point.
Also, Rose is free to do what she wants because she's good cult little baby.
Yep.
Darlene kind of talks shit to Billy. A power outage happens, and Billy, well, Flynn also admits he's not a priest to Miles, who really wants to confess some things. Like, yep. He really wants to confess his sins.
He's in desperate need of confessing his sins, like, because he was raised as a good Christian boy, and all the stuff he's doing is weighing on his guilty conscience.
But I'm sure it's not that bad.
Nah.
Anyway, Father Flynn launches himself out of the chair, headbutts Billy. Also, Rose set up some fire, so when the power went out, now there's just fire lighting everything.
Yep.
Fight breaks out. Darlene kicks over the table to help stop some things. Fucking Flynn just tackles Billy through fire.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome, I'm not gonna lie.
Like, he might be an old man, but Jesus Christ, he can fight. It takes good three God. People to stop him.
It does, yeah. It takes three cult leaders to stop one old man. It's like, I'd be scared to see him back in his prime. My God.
No wonder he robbed banks. Yeah. Jesus Christ.
Yeah, for real.
During this, Miles is closest to the Darlene's revolver on the ground. Well, I guess it's Dwight's.
Mm-hmm.
And... she's like, you fucking use it, fucking help.
Yeah.
And he's like, I can't kill anymore. She stops her moment and is like, how many have you killed?
And he's like 123 or something.
123. Turns out Miles is a Vietnam veteran and he was really good at his job.
Oh, yeah. He was like, you know, scary sniper you see with a rifle just tung, 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 killing people.
And just wakes up in a field of bodies.
Yeah.
I don't think all were done by him, but we never get confirmation on that.
We don't know. Yeah.
But he does eventually decide to be scary. He gets up, grabs the pistol, headshot, shoots Chris Hemsworth. Well, no, he shoots Billy right in the face.
Yeah.
Shoots the two cult followers who are in there. Kicks up, breaks free of his restraints, kicks a shotgun up into his hands, goes out and snipes the last two cult members.
Yeah, that kick to his hands was rad as fuck.
So fucking cool.
Yeah, and then he decided to peek it, so bad idea.
The cult member tried to peek. It didn't fucking work.
Yeah, good job.
Rose goes on top of Billy, like, why are you dead? And Miles tries to comfort her, but the kid's got a knife. And stabs Miles. Also, the place is on fire due to the fight. Yeah.
So how do they kill Rose again?
Father Flynn has the pistol. Oh, they switch guns.
That's right.
And Flynn shoots a child like a good priest.
Oof.
Oof. Hey, man, she sinned. And as Miles is dying, Flynn still, even though not a priest, still allows him to confess.
Yeah, give him his last rites.
Yeah. Which, do you need a priest to do that?
If it's like Catholicism, what they're going for, yeah, you need a priest for last rites. Not anyone can do it.
Sorry, I'm just imagining, like, you're in a car crash, and they just, like, call up, hey.
Yeah. Hey, man, can you, like, perform last rites for me? I'm, like, totally gonna die, dude.
There is nothing below me.
Like, wow, I'm surprised I'm still conscious at the moment.
Is that too dark?
That's really dark.
It's really dark. I apologize.
Oh, boy.
But with that, the only survivors are, I've been saying her name, Darlene, and Flynn. They grab the money and run. And we see, I think it's a few months later.
Mm-hmm.
They use the money well. Darlene is now a lead singer in Reno.
Yep, she's actually doing well because everyone knows her name. They're like, and it's Darlene. So, yay.
And Flynn is there in a nice white suit.
Yep.
To support her.
And for the credits, she sings Hold On, I'm Coming.
Gross. The dress was pretty, though.
It was. I want one. That green dress, right?
So sparkly.
Yeah. It's like emerald.
See, summary only took almost half an hour.
Yeah.
But that's also adding in the intro stuff.
Exactly. So, 20 minutes, I'd say, probably.
20, 25.
Yeah. So, that was Bad Times at the Al Royale. I don't know why I keep saying Al. El.
Also, I'd like to note that the whole thing of the Fed dying, we see the Fed die first, and then we cut back to Flynn Darlene's story, and then we see Emily's story, and then we go back to Miles and Flynn. It's a whole Christopher Nolan-ass thing.
Yeah, like, he keeps coming back and forth, like, going back in time, and you see this person, and blah, 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 blah. So.
But then we get back to order after that.
Yes, because it's cool the way to do that. They're like, you know, room two or room three or whatever.
Yeah, so. I like the title card system.
Yeah.
So where the fuck to start?
Jesus, yeah, I don't even know, but it's just the movie in general was just a really nice unexpected pleasure, because, like I said, I went into it as blind as possible, so.
I don't know if you I think I might have been blinder, because I thought it was the wrong movie.
You thought it was the wrong movie, yeah.
I picked the wrong movie. Yeah. I thought it was a completely different film.
And the funny thing about that is you said Hotel Artemis actually was not as good.
That's why I paused for a second. I was thinking, should I mention that? Yeah, Hotel Artemis is not nearly as good as this. I mean, it's a fine movie. If you wanted to watch it, I can't say don't, but it's just fine.
Yeah.
This one's way more interesting.
Yeah, definitely. And it does a great job of holding your attention for the full runtime. So it is.
Yeah, it didn't feel like 2.5 hours.
It didn't. No, it's very interesting. Very well done. So I think it helps. Like, the plot helps, definitely. Like, it starts out and it does kind of the Hateful Eight thing where you're introduced to all the characters right away. Like, they're all coming into the hotel. Then you get a hold on their personalities, how they act, stuff like that.
Yeah.
So, and then once that's established, they go into the crazy stuff.
It's like Clue, but violent.
Yes, exactly. Way more violent. And there are several murders in Clue, so.
Spoilers.
Oh, no.
Did you know, based on the game Clue, a game about murder, there will be murder in the movie based on Clue, the game?
Wow. But.
Well, there's also Tim Curry.
There is also Tim Curry.
Tim Curry.
But, I quite enjoyed it. I guess we'll start. Let's start with the actors. All the actors do a great job.
Everyone's so fucking good. I love Darlene. I hope to see her in
whoever
more movies.
Did Darlene is fantastic. Yeah, she definitely needs to be in more things. Didn't you look her up? Wasn't she in a couple other things? Or
I don't remember what she was in.
I think Alex looked her up.
Yeah, she
was in, she was Harriet Tubman in the Harriet Tubman
movie. Yeah, in a recent movie.
Yeah. But she does a fantastic job. Of course, Jeff Bridges, you gotta love him.
Jeff Bridges is solid in his role, and you actually feel kind of bad for him when he does talk about his Alzheimer's.
Yeah, for real. It is definitely an issue that hits really hard for anyone who's been through that with relatives and shit. So
I also like the reasoning of him dressed as a priest, just people don't ask questions.
Exactly. People tend to look the other way when you're dressed as a priest. So,
who was Dwight? Again, he's from Mad Men.
Oh, yeah. John Hamm.
John Hamm. John Hamm, for the short time he's in the movie, really good.
He does do a really good job, yeah. So
he gets off that scumbag vibe as a good cover that it's like, oh, shit, he's not that.
Yeah, exactly. He's actually a fed, but yeah, he does.
So even more of a scumbag.
Exactly.
Fucking narcs.
Yeah.
Which literally, if he just did his job, none of this would have happened.
Exactly. J. Edgar Hoover told him, literally, just so we're clear, I'll say it again, do not get involved. Get shot. Bum, 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 bum.
As that music plays, it like shows everything getting worse and worse.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, all that would have happened logically is probably...
because the cult would have come to get them anyway.
No, they didn't know where they were. Emily had to call... well, not Emily. Rose had to call them.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
So the only thing that would have happened would have been between Darlene and Flynn.
Yeah, that whole thing would have worked itself out. So, and they probably would have gotten away with it, too, had it not been for the cult. So
I mean, they did, technically. They still got the money.
That is true. That is true.
No one burned it.
No.
Because the cult was going to take that money.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, Flynn does a really good job. I like Miles.
The guy who plays Miles does a really good job. Like, he does a good job playing, like, the really meek, like, wimpy, like, the guy with a dark past. But then when he goes full badass mode, he is pretty good at that. So
I know I've kept making jokes about, or off mic, whatever.
Making jokes about, technically both right now. Technically, so. Yes.
But I've been comparing him to Alfred. But for those who don't know, in the fucking comics, Alfred is the last line of defense for the Batcave with a shotgun.
That's it. It's just one old man with a shotgun.
Which, by that logic, Miles is the only protector of this hotel.
Yeah.
And he's a scary motherfucker.
Oh, yeah. It's like, because that's the thing about Batman, too, is you gotta think he has the whole Batcave, all these crazy gadgets, but last line of defense is Alfred with a fucking shotgun. That's scary.
Also, for those who decide not to watch the movie, the reason it's a perv hotel is it was literally used to get blackmail on political figures.
Yeah, because there's a tape. They never explain who it is.
It's JFK.
But it's probably JFK is what you can deduce from it. They're like, oh, wait, look who that is or whatever. So,
but yeah, basically, they'd move the camera room to room. They had it bugged. And Miles has been there for years, and he tells some pretty fucked up shit.
Oh, yeah. Ugh. Like, yeah, because he just had, you know, hotel management or whatever. He would just, they would call him, tell him
studio
which rooms
management.
To do. Yeah, exactly. But they would just call him, tell him which ones to do, and then send it anonymously to a P.O. box in Pennsylvania. So.
All right. I would say Emily and Rose are, like, the weakest.
Mm-hmm.
But that's because everyone else is doing really fucking good.
Oh, yeah. Like, it's kind of hard to compete with all the other actors. Like
Chris Hemsworth, once he's in, is chewing that scenery.
It's great. He's having so much fun being this creepy, scummy cult leader. Like,
he just has a great time and a great body.
Oh, God, yes. Yeah, those muscles, though. Mm.
Why do I have a feeling this was... so I get to be a cocky asshole, and I don't have to wear a shirt.
Exactly! All right, I'm in.
Sold. Actually, wait, no, he's worked with the director before. He's in Cabin in the Woods.
Oh, yeah, he is!
I always
he?
Forget he's in it, because his haircut is different.
I always do, too, yeah. Is he, like, the bike guy?
Yeah, he's the biker boyfriend.
Yeah, I forgot about that. And we're not saying anything else because we're not going to spoil that movie because...
that's what this director's good at. He's good at making movies where you don't want to tell anyone anything.
He really is. So,
as we say, doing a podcast, telling you everything about the movie. We told you to watch it. Fuck you.
The thing about Cabin in the Woods is, like, us, and, you know, the rabid fan base would actually get furious with us if we spoiled it. Like, people get mad if you spoil Cabin.
I think enough time has passed where that's died down a bit. Yeah. But if they're told, like, oh, this person spoiled it for me, you're dead.
Oh, yeah. You're a dead man. Straight up. That fan base is strong. Like, they feel very heavily about that.
But yeah, and also all the characters are well-written. Their motives make sense.
Exactly. There was none where I felt like, yeah, that was weak. Like, but...
Like, yes, Dwight ruined everything. But, you know, he saw a little girl tied up, and it was like, I need to stop that.
He saw a hostage and a little girl tied up at gunpoint. Yeah. So, I think it would have been he would have been a worse person if he actually followed the orders. So...
Fucking feds.
I know.
Now where to go?
Yeah. Well, I think the technical stuff is where we can go from there, because I love the cinematography.
Oh, the symmetrical cinematography. Yeah. Like, you have a hotel split in half. You better shoot fucking symmetrically.
Exactly. Like, there's a lot of faraway shots of, like, the people coming in, and there's a lot of really nice scenery and the sets and all that. They really use all of the sets, and it's really cool. Like, the cinematography reminded me a lot of the Grand Budapest Hotel.
Yeah, it just kept very symmetrical and wide.
Yeah.
There's always a lot of stuff happening in the background and foreground. Even the, like, motel rooms are really nice to the eye, and they have different colors.
Yeah, like, I think the one Darlene's seeing is purple, yeah?
Yeah. So. Oh, no, purple. Go watch the Old Boy episode.
Please do. We're referencing our own episodes a lot.
It's movie month.
Yes, it
is. I wish we had a jingle. Damn it.
We do have that, yeah, that I had.
It's not a jingle. That's not a screaming. Jingle.
It's,
yeah,
it's a rock song.
A song of rocks.
Yes.
Clink, clink, clink.
But yeah, that's just really well shot. I had something else. I forget where I was going to go with it. Shit.
Gore.
Shit. Oh, the gore is great. Oh, like,
the film opens with the thing gang with the camera gang covered in blood because the shotgun blast goes right through the dude.
Goes right through the dude, and like the blood just from his back splatters all over the camera. It's great. It's a great opening kill, and I didn't expect it. So.
And do you realize that opening shot gives away the mirrors?
Yeah.
Because
yeah,
you get a moment where he's doing that, like he's fixing up his hair as he's waiting for people to show up.
Yep. Yep.
I was like, oh. They're just telling you, okay.
It's clever. It's a nice, subtle way to do it.
But yeah, like the head whips or the headshots at the end from Miles.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. The gore is... The practical effects are great, so...
Or even Miles, like, the little holes from all the bullets and the blood looked really good on him, too.
They did. Also, something else I loved is the sound effects had a punch to them.
Like. Oh, the sound effects were great. Especially, Darlene's bottle smack, like you hear
hitting him over the head with the bottle. That just, it's a good shock moment because it's from Jeff Bridges' perspective. You see him drugging it, and he turns around and all of a sudden just thump.
How'd she sneak up on him? She takes off her heels so she can sneak on the floor. Mm-hmm. But it was well designed because you hear the thunk of the bottle, and then as it follows through, it breaks.
Yeah, it's not just the glass shattering, it's actually more realistic as you would hear that and then so.
Yeah, I felt that was, like, a really nice touch.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like, you knew it was coming, but it still jumped you.
It still did, because the pacing is weird on it.
It is. It is just really, a really good unexpected moment. Like I said, it's from Jeff Bridges' perspective, so the audience doesn't expect as much as he did.
I remember first time watching, I was like, oh, fuck, he's gonna drug her, and then just, oh, shit, she hit him!
How did she end up knowing again?
She's just been on enough bad dates.
That's fair.
Like, that's what she says, she's just been with enough bad people.
Because he says, I'm not a priest, and she's like, no shit.
Darlene's so good.
She is great. I love how snarky she is at times. And then I love the line of Jeff Bridges too. It's like, where Chris Hemsworth was like, oh, if you're such a good singer, then sing for us. He's like, no, don't sing for him. He doesn't deserve to hear your voice. Fuck him.
I do love Chris Hemsworth's reaction of, because the whole reason to sing is to stop from playing the game. And all. He cuts her off and spins it and says, I heard better.
Yeah.
So fucking
and
rude.
That is what sets Jeff Bridges
That's
off.
That's it, yeah.
That's when he goes up and starts to...
Just headbutts him.
Yeah. So, that was so well done. Yeah, and speaking of sound design, too, the music is great. has that very 60s, 70s swing, like, soul music, because Darlene's a soul singer. Mm-hmm. So I love that shit. Oh, my God.
Did they choose less popular songs because it sounded cooler and was less cliche, or because it was cheaper? You be the judge.
Yep. Yeah, there are a lot of very deep cuts. Like, there are a couple well-known ones, like The Letter is a well-known one. The one she was singing as they were covering up, I forget which one that was, but that's a well-known one. Hold On, I'm Coming is well-known. But yeah, there were a lot of ones that even, like, I didn't know. I just found them really catchy. And, like,
I still love that you're a Deep Purple fan, and even the characters didn't know it was Deep Purple.
Because I was like, as soon as I heard the, oh, like the wolf, I'm like, oh shit, it's Deep Purple. And they're like, who is this? Deep Purple, I think. It's great.
Just so rude.
I know. Even he just showed me, he's like, see, even back then they didn't care. Oh, God. Yeah, so I love the soundtrack. And the person who played Darlene is a legit good singer.
She sounds fantastic.
Like, wow. And I love, too, when, like, they're listening to them in the hallway and they flip on the microphone or whatever. That's surprisingly high quality for a creeper mic.
Hey, you need to pick up everything, I guess.
Yeah. When he turns it on, like, the reverb from the hallway just kind of adds a natural reverb instead of sounding flat. I just thought that was a nice touch.
Yeah, it gave us... And as he got further away to see the room with the hostage, it sounds creepier because it's distant.
Yes. So that was just really well done.
Something I also liked with the camera work, when Dwight is in the back room, his reflection is in the window, so he's kind of like a ghost in the room. Huh. But while Darlene is singing, he actually moves, so that way he isn't blocking her in the shot.
Yeah, that's so cool.
I was like, fuck, I don't understand blocking in general, and you're doing it with reflections.
Yeah. Oh, I love shots like that, like where a character's in a mirror or something, or like when you don't know it's a mirror. I love that too. Like the one where you can see him there, but then like he walks into frame. I was like, oh shit.
Oh yeah, as he's looking for bugs.
Yeah, that was just cool. I love shit like that.
I need to show you one shot. I forget what movie it's from, but it's like a little girl and you see her running at the camera, but it zooms out and it's actually as she like reaches forward towards the camera, it zooms out and was looking at a mirror cabinet and she opens it.
Oh, that's awesome.
And it's like a smooth transition.
Oh, that's so cool.
I forget the movie it's from though.
Oh man, I love that. Oh, so good.
Yeah, honestly, I can't praise this movie enough. Yeah. It's so well-paced.
Well, the video stopped recording, so...
Well, okay, we're
I guess it's going to be just audio only for here on out for you YouTube listeners.
Here's the cool...
I forgot to move all the rest of them over to my hard drive, so that was my fault, so...
Well, here's the cool background I made that audio listeners see as the thumbnail.
Yes, there you go, so...
I do it for every episode, please.
You do.
Please acknowledge them.
Yeah, I acknowledge them, don't worry. It's okay.
Teller's Place did make the base image. I just added in Photoshop in certain ways.
So, yeah, actually, I think we're about done, aren't we? Is there anything else big that you can think of? Or?
I'm trying to think because there's so much good in this movie.
There it is. It's just so well put together. And the guy was the guy from Daredevil, right? He also directed episodes.
Yeah, he did. Between Cabin in the Woods and here, he did episodes of Daredevil.
Which you can tell that he learned from the cinematography.
Oh, the use of shadow and shit?
It's great.
So fucking good. I love the rain as well.
Yeah.
Like just the glow of neon signs lighting up that outside parking lot.
Yeah, same with when, like, Darlene's in the car and she's looking at, like, she's looking out the window of the car or whatever, and you can see, like, the neon sign as the rain's coming down. It's so pretty.
So much water, though.
So much water.
Actually, wait, what are the fucking chances that it rained in Nevada and California?
Yeah, right? I was saying, I wonder how often that is, like, on board. Like, I know that, like, it's not, like, physics, you know? Like, it doesn't just stop right when it hits the border.
That can happen, though.
I know.
I've seen rain like that, where you are literally, like, just outside the storm.
I have, too. Actually, well, I was driving with my dad one time a long time ago. Like, you can sometimes, like, hit the wall of rain, so...
That's how it is when you enter Ohio, to go to the alternate dimension.
It is! It is! Because I remember that happened when you guys were driving. It just stopped. It's like, oh, we're in Ohio.
Yeah, there was a ton... There was... a part of the highway with the sign, it was like, and right before it was nothing, rain. Welcome to Ohio. No rain.
Well, there you go. It's what happens in the wormhole. It's weird.
Um, Yeah, I think that's about it.
Yeah, so definitely a great movie. Highly recommended. So,
it was a fun time.
It was, in fact, a good time at the El Royale.
Yeah, it was a bit bad.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, people died and stuff, but man, like, I just...
You know, it's movies like this, you think critics would be mad that it's good, because, like, I could have fucking said, it's a bad time at the El Royale for the fucking audience.
Yeah, right? Like, for that review or whatever they post online, it's like, damn it, that would have been a good title.
But no, you decide to go and be good.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Yay!
We have 4 movies left.
Getting down to it.
We have The Void, Heathers, Mandy, and Lucky Number 11.
Yes.
So, let us... Spin! I was right.
All
right,
good job. Hey, you called it.
Next, we are covering The Void.
The Void.
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 Void. Void. Does it always echo like that? No, only when you say void.
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 Dang it.